All right, welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
I'm Katie Halper.
How was your week, Katie Halper?
It was good, Matt Taibbi. How was yours?
It was okay. I sort of got canceled again a little bit.
Oh, because of your white fragility piece?
Yeah. But that's okay. I'm going to set the all-time record, I'm hoping.
Well, Matt, is it triggering your white fragility? Do you feel like you're
absolutely
going to crumple into a corner? And
I do. Yeah. I do. I feel like retreating from the habitus.
Oh my God, yeah. Do you think we could get her on, Robin DeAngelis?
Yeah, somebody was saying like, hey, you know, if you're going to be so nasty, you should have her on to.
Yeah.
So Robin DeAngelis, if you want to come on the show, we are very glad to have you.
Robin, this is a safe space.
It's a safe space. We will treat you with kid gloves. There won't be any difficult questions at all.
No.
We'll be happy to have you on. So otherwise, the world still sucks, right?
Yeah, I think so.
First of all, cases are skyrocketing. So death is imminent.
Cases of COVID, just so people.
Yes. And then there's a new strain of H1N1. You heard about that?
That's a swine thing?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So we got that to look forward to too. So all in all, things are good. All right. So what happened in the world this week? What do we have for Democrats suck?
So for Democrats suck, we have a very interesting story. It's kind of, and it's a story within a story, but let's set up the first part. Dan, can we show the video of St. Louis Mayor Lida Crewson? Lida or Lida? I'm not sure, but Lida Crewson. Basically what happens is she, during a Facebook Live, responding to questions and decided it would be a good idea to read this. Well, actually, let's just play it. I think it'll be fun to watch it reveal. But you're going to see she's going to read some feedback that she got. And she presents it like she's being a very responsible public figure and just sharing the feedback of her constituents.
Rachel has a question, Mayor, about your meeting today with some demonstrators outside City Hall. She wants mm-hmm. to know, how was that meeting and what did you talk about?
Well, thank you for that, Rachel. So there was a demonstration here in front, sort of on Tucker and Market here, and the demonstrators wanted to meet with me. So I went outside City Hall in the circle on the Tucker side of City Hall. The conversation wasn't really a two-way conversation, I'll be honest with you, because there was a very loud, very loud response from the demonstrators. And so they gave me some papers about how they thought. In fact, I'll go pick it up off my desk. Hang on.
I like this already.
I know, it's great, right?
They presented some papers to me about how they wanted the budget to be spent. Here's one that wants $50 million to go to cure violence, $75 million to go to affordable housing, $60 million to go to health and human services, and have zero go to the police. So that's...
Nope. What happened?
So no, Matt, what she's doing there, the reason we don't hear this is because it's been edited. Because had you been watching this video in real time, you would have heard her reading the names of these people in full transparency who were making these suggestions and giving their addresses. So she doxed her constituents. And I love the way she does it in such a, like, there's no, you know, she does it as if she's just sharing and giving feedback and being a good representative of her constituents. But it's hilarious because, first of all, I like the way she's like, well, actually, you know what? Let me get those letters. Let me get them. And it has all the naturalness and organicness.
Right. Just spur of the moment.
Spur of the moment. It reminds me of when Hillary Clinton said, back in 2008, when she was being asked why she didn't drop out of the primary, and she said, well, you know, my husband didn't. They said, you don't believe in that party unity stuff? She goes, no, I mean, because my husband didn't drop out until June. In June, we all remember June. June, of course, is when Bobby Kennedy was killed.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Like it just occurred to her.
Yeah, just occurred to me to use the assassination of Bobby Kennedy to justify staying in a race against Obama, who had like unparalleled.
That was sweet. That was good acting, actually, on
her part.
Yeah. No, I mean, in both of these cases.
Oh yeah, right. I think they did a lot of character. What do you think they like took some improv courses beforehand?
She found her center.
Yeah.
I think that was really good.
It was really good, right?
Yeah,
and so
yeah,
she goes through and she keeps. Now, the problem is that I think that the people, it's been removed for Facebook and she apologized, big deal. But I mean, I don't know how you could not apologize for doxing your constituents. But the problem is, I don't know if lip readers could understand what she's saying. I thought that they were going to do the pixelating in front of her mouth. I mean, they mute it, but I don't know.
I should have put like a Raleigh Fingers mustache.
Yeah, exactly.
Her, like a, you know.
A much bigger one to cover them. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
But can you, it's like so disgusting. Let's just watch a few more seconds of this. Just watch how passive aggressive she is.
Affordable housing, $100 million to health and human services, zero to police. Same address.
Names.
This is interesting. All these folks are at the same address. So maybe this is an office. Well, here's somebody.
I like the way she goes, that's interesting. All these folks. So that's like two passive aggressive terms in one, because the that's interesting or that's funny. That one is even more annoying. You're like, oh, it's so funny. It's so funny, Matt, how you always do that. It's so funny, Matt, that you like never remember to do ABC or what, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
It's such I hate that. Like, oh no, it's just funny. It's just funny that you never remember to call me back. It's just funny. It's funny.
I'm sorry. As a person who is prone to seething, I appreciate the seething in this scene. Like she's a very good seether.
I feel like it's below the surface. It's not that perceptible though.
I think it's very perceptible. Don't you think? I mean, she's seething with a capital S. Don't you think?
But I think she's like doing. She's trying to seem chill, right?
Well, I mean, she's trying to seem like chill in the sense of like she would like to freeze you with her words so that you break ice.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. It is kind of hilarious, actually.
It's like one of the X-Men characters or something like that. She's shooting freezing rays out of her eyes or something like that. It's excellent.
And so she does that. She goes, that's interesting, which is basically the equivalent of it's just funny. Like, but the other thing she does is folks. Interesting,
folks.
These folks, it's like, okay, first of all, I hate that word. And
okay.
Second of all, it's so hokey, and it's like, you know, it's like when Bush was like, some of these folks talking about Al-Qaeda. It's like, why are you using that term?
So folks is a personal bugbear of mine. I started to go crazy with that word with Obama in 2008. Because I used to have this system for... I didn't want to be taking notes of all the cliches for each of the candidates. I would just have like number systems because you would memorize each of their stump lines. So when I would do speeches, it would just say things like 1, 9, 11, 14, right? And then it would go back and reconstruct what they were. So like for Howard Dean, you know, or Mike Dukakis, I didn't do him, but you know, if I'm... I don't just believe in the American dream. I'm a product of it, right? That might have been number 7, right? So but with Obama, he had like so many different folks lines that it got confusing after a while. Like he just inserted it into every single one of his cliches, which made it very difficult to keep them apart. Biden is also a master of the folks.
Oh really?
In fact, see if we can find it. He did it in his announcement last year. His launch speech last year contained 35 uses of the word folks. And as I noted in a piece last year, this included a rare double folks. And here's the quote, folks, I know some of the really smart folks say that Democrats don't want to hear about unity. So I'm waiting for someone to go for a triple folks. I think that would be really funny.
What the folks. I think that we're excluding Bush, and I think we need to incorporate his use of the word folks, because I actually think he out-folkses Obama.
Really?
And, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, let's see.
All right.
This government does not torture people.
We tortured some folks.
This government does not torture people.
We tortured some folks.
So that, I feel like you maybe neglected... Matt, you neglected actually the best Obama folks reference.
Right, we tortured some folks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's a great moment in the history of folks. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then, but then I want to just play this little thing, Dan, if you can play the next one, which is an important, I think, moment in folksism.
And to conduct a full-scale investigation to hunt down and to find those folks who committed this act.
To find the folks who committed this act.
This was George Bush talking about 9/11.
Talk about folks.
Talk about folks. But Like, isn't that weird? It's kind of cute. It's like, it's I don't think Bush was trying to humanize them, but it almost comes off like he does.
We're gonna find, yeah, it's folk terrorism.
Yeah, it's folk terrorism. Yeah, it's folk terrorism. Yeah, I expect him to be like, we're gonna find these folks and we're gonna try to talk to them about the history of imperial violence, and then we're gonna try to de-radicalize them, and you know, which will cut down on you know, like, it's like he's gonna launch into some Chomskyan.
Right.
Okay, so there's that, and I think that's a pretty good Democrat suck, right?
Very but good, yeah. Thank
you very much. Not only did that happen, but this led to a really interesting story where basically there was a protest against this mayor, understandably, because she sucks. And now that we've exposed her on Democrat Suck, I expect there to be a much more organized protest against her that'll be actually successful. So what happened was that these protesters were walking to...
Oh, right. This led to the whole thing with the guns, right?
Yeah. So this caused people to march to protest the mayor. And basically, they were calling on her to resign, which is very understandable. And when they got there, they were greeted... They passed a house on the way. So they were going to St. Louis Mayor Lyda Crewson's house a block, and on their way, they passed through this other house owned by these people, a couple named the McCloskeys. And according to Mark McCloskey, the husband, he said that, "I really thought it was storming the Bastille. We'd be dead and the house would be burned." And if we could just look at some of the footage and see how they responded to the protesters.
A large crowd of very angry, shouting, aggressive people poured through.
Tonight, the couple seen in this now viral video is detailing what they say was strictly self-defense. Mark McCloskey and his wife stood on their patio Sunday night, pointing guns at a crowd of protesters.
I was terrified that we'd be murdered within seconds, that our house would be burned down, that our pets would be killed.
McCloskey says he and his wife called 911 and grabbed their guns as they heard the crowd approaching from afar. Video from another angle shows protesters chanting while walking into their private gated community, which appears to be open. But McCloskey says the key is required and later shared these photos of the gate destroyed.
I stood up and announced loudly, "This is private property. Please go back, leave." As soon as I said the words private property, it enraged the crowd. There was then a horde of people coming through the broken gate.
Anyway, what's interesting about that is it's a nice callback to the Mark Levin, Charlie Kirk romance, Good Morning America.
Oh, right, yeah.
The role of private property. Remember that?
Yeah, I hate this story. I don't want to go anywhere near this story because it's full of this is a classic story where the pictures are right. are more powerful than the facts. So yeah. I don't know what the facts are yet.
Okay, so we can return to it, but this is the important part. Okay.
Yeah.
This is to me. Well, so this is interesting because we have this story about the mayor of St. Louis who's like passive aggressive, like dart throwing from her eyes. Sociopath doxing her own constituents. That leads to a protest, which leads to this these lawyers coming outside of their mansion on their being, you know, standing on the deck or the terrace, whatever it's called, of their mansion with guns. But then what's interesting is they've now released a statement, these lawyers. The peaceful protests were not the subject of scorn or disdain by the McCloskeys. To the contrary, they're expecting and supportive of the message of the protesters. And it says, the Black Lives Matters movement is here to stay. It is the right message, and it is about time. The McCloskeys want to make sure that no one thinks less of BLM, its message, and the means it is employing to get its message out because of the actions of a few white individuals who tarnished the peaceful protest.
Okay, well, that makes me think they actually are guilty.
Right? Yeah. Right? Well, I mean, because the idea that they are... It's funny. This is so cool. It's like a Pandora's box because, like, within that statement, they do the whole like it's white violent protesters. They're using all these talking points. I mean, they don't say the Russian outside agitators. But so, what do you mean by that? Just in case our listeners don't get it, Matt, what do you mean when you say that makes you think they're guilty?
Because they wouldn't be doing all this virtue signaling about right. about their how down they are with Black Lives Matter if they weren't feeling a little bit guilty about having right, jumped right. to certain conclusions. So.
Right, exactly. Or I mean, I don't know if it's guilty or as much as it is damage control. But I just think it's
could
funny
be
they, put
one.
Out their, they put out that statement through their lawyer. But Dan, can you show this picture I found of them? So after I read this statement where they expressed their support of Black Lives Matter and how it's a movement that's here to stay, I thought it was they were being disingenuous. But then I found this photo, and I actually believe that they are real allies. So
I kind of had a feeling you were going someplace like that.
Yeah, so for listeners only of the show, I discovered a photo of Kathleen Cleaver and Bobby Seals of the Black Panthers, but that's historically what we've thought of it, and it turns out it's actually the McCloskey couple.
Right.
And he's wearing a beret, and she has an afro, and is...
It's McCloskey Carmichael.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
So I think we all learned a lot.
We did. We learned something today.
We did, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent. All right, cool. Well, I have something far less interesting for Republican suck. Dan, if we could open the text to businesswoman upsets five-term congressman in Colorado primary. So here's what we need to know. A woman named Lauren Boebert has won the Republican primary, upsetting five-term Colorado Congressman Scott Tipton, who was endorsed by Donald Trump. The interesting thing about this story, I think the significance of it, is that Boebert is probably, she might be the first sort of openly QAnon endorsing politician who's going to make it all the way to a general election. I'm not sure about that. If listeners and viewers have information to the contrary, please let me know. But here, this is Boebert earlier this year when asked about QAnon, and we'll get into what QAnon is later. Everything that I've heard of Q, I hope that this is real because it only means that America is getting stronger and better and people are returning to conservative values.
She calls it Q. That's cute.
Well, I mean, anybody who reads the breadcrumbs of Q would refer to Q that way.
Got it.
Okay. Are you not familiar with
QAnon? I'm not very fluent in QAnon.
All right, so QAnon, if you're not familiar with the theology of it, is basically this notion that there is a secret investigator named Q, and I haven't followed this recently, so I can't remember exactly what the latest permutation of the theory is, but I think basically the idea is that this secret investigator has been assigned by Donald Trump to gather the evidence that will uncover the great conspiracy to end all conspiracies, and there's going to be a prosecution. It's basically Russiagate, but like way more elaborate, because Q is basically the Robert Mueller figure of the right.
Right.
Except that he's sort of more fictional than the legend of Robert Mueller was. And if Dan, if we could show a chart that was compiled of the various intertwining theories of QAnon, you can see here all the different connections that Q has uncovered. And as you can see, basically everything is connected to everything else. You've got Big Pharma is connected to depopulation, which is connected to the military-industrial complex, connected to the protocols of the Elders of Zion, Zoroastrianism.
I feel seen, yeah.
The FBI, the Freemasonry.
The CIA is at the center. I like that.
CIA, the Lincoln assassination, FEMA camps, the Russian Federation mass surveillance, 9/11, Black Knight satellite, Draco reptilians. It's just, so it all kind of fits together, right? It's like a unified field theory of, to be fair, this chart I think was compiled by somebody else.
It could be worth pointing out just how chaotic it looks for the people who aren't seeing it. It is this really good representation of what I could imagine the mind
Of
a QAnon follower being. Right. It's these things that come up in bold that sort of stick out, but it's just pure chaos. It's just endless thought cycles that can sort of fold onto each other.
Yeah. It reminds me of, do you watch the show Homeland ever?
Yes.
It's like Carrie's board, bulletin board.
Right. The thing that jumped to mind for me was the song Alice's Restaurant by Arlo Guthrie with the 28x7 color glossy photos with the circles and arrows, right?
Like, yeah.
Which you know, just sort of depicts the grand scheme of things. Anyway, great stuff. If you read Q, Q basically communicates to the world through what they call like breadcrumbs, where he sends out little hints about, you know, the ongoing investigation or whatever the hell is going on. And so, and, you know, you have to have kind of a next level craziness to really embrace this thing. And people do. So now we have someone who's nearer to the U.S. Congress.
Right.
Who, you know, seems to like this thing.
Who will speak for the QAnon followers.
Right, right.
This woman.
Now, to be completely fair, I think it's important to point out that there are charts that rival this one for incoherence on the Russia front, but this one is like six or seven factors more right. crazy than.
And also, these are like how far from this center is this versus in other words, Russiagate stuff has total current like mainstream currency.
Right. Yes.
Cachet, right? It's totally yeah. part. We see it on MSNBC, NBC, CBS, ABC, right? So the ratio of like of insanity to mainstream is much higher.
Yeah, I think when you do adjust for the equation, yeah, I don't know how mathematically you would do it, but it comes out to be pretty close. But this is pretty nuts. So anyway, good, great news, right? Republicans, let's hope there are more of these folks.
And
coming.
This is the person Trump did not endorse.
Right, and the hilarious part about that, and first of all, it's politically significant for a couple of reasons. Because Trump has now had a series of these situations where the people he's endorsed have lost primaries, which is a huge thing, because that wouldn't have been even remotely close to possible even a couple of years ago. But the Boebert actually beat this Tipton character because she argued that he was insufficiently supportive of Trump, even though the Tipton is actually sort of is in Trump's campaign. I think he's the Colorado something chairman. I forget what he
guess he was just the Tipton.
We need a rim shot for that one.
I know, yeah. He even has the drum set. Listeners may not know this, but Matt has a drum set behind him.
So anyway, that was Republicans. Republicans suck. What do we have for Isn't That Weird this week?
So for Isn't That Weird, I mean, it was hard for me to settle on one thing. And, you know, what do they say? Good things come in threes. Is that, I believe?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So apparently weird things come in threes also. So we have a kind of holy trinity of penis related stories.
Excellent.
Yeah.
That's so weird because I chose a trinity of Isn't That Terrible stories. But anyway, go ahead.
Well, actually, I kind of felt like maybe these should be terrible. I don't want to kind of dismiss the seriousness of this and the terror of this. But let's start with India, where a man put a cell phone charger up his penis. It got stuck in his bladder and had to be removed by surgeons. And we actually have the photo of it. We have both an x-ray and the photo of it removed. I don't think this is... Oh, he put the... I get it. I was going to say it's not the full charger. It's the cord. It's not the...
Yeah, it's the cord.
To be fair, it was just the cord, just the tip of the charger.
Let's see the picture. Come on.
Further than the tip. Okay, yeah, I have it. It's in there. So there's the x-ray. And you see it. It's just like right there in the bladder. And it looks almost like a pasta noodle, like it almost looks like a fettuccine.
It's fresh pasta.
Fresh, very fresh, yeah. And you just see it's really quite horrible. And if you scroll down, Dan, we'll actually see it removed. So what happened was an Indian man who went to hospital with abdominal pain had inserted a mobile phone charger cable into his penis. He visited a hospital in northeastern India, claiming he had ingested some earphones. But when the cord didn't appear despite the patient being prescribed laxatives, doctors resorted to surgery. The doctor said he came to us after 5 days, and despite passing stool several times, the cable did not come out. We then conducted an endoscopy, but still couldn't find anything. As the patient complained of severe pain, we decided to perform surgery and found that there was nothing in his intestine. It was at that point that an x-ray revealed the man to have a 2-foot-long charging cable in his bladder inserted via his urethra, the tube that leads from the penis to the bladder. Then I made incision there and took out the cord, which was actually a charging cable of over 2 feet long. If he had been honest, then it would have saved us the trouble and we could have treated him sooner. So
let that be a lesson to you.
I know. Then the doctor said, I've read that people used to get sexual gratification by inserting instruments through the penis. This is one such case, and the psychiatrist can help him beyond this point.
Tells you something about his knowledge of anatomy, first of all.
I mean, I guess he was lying, right?
Well, yes, but the fact that he thought that...
I see. He thought he could trick them. Oh, I see.
Right, because
right.
If you ingest it, it's going to go into your diet.
Then your urethra, the penis.
It's not going to end up in your bladder. What, you have two more penis?
Yeah, that's penis story number one. Now let's go into number two. Sex addict claims hot female gamers caused him to injure his penis. I hate when that happens.
I love people.
A gamer is very angry that he was caught, that he was forced basically to harm his penis. What happened was a sex addict, well, I got to read the lead to the opening sentence for this. Excessive gaming is known to damage one's joystick. A California sex addict is suing the video streaming platform Twitch for $25 million after claiming that the site's overabundance of scantily clad gamers have caused him to injure his penis, according to the lawsuit. In the legal document filed at a Santa Clara County court on June 15, San Francisco's Eric Estavillo claimed that the Amazon subsidiary had, quote, subjected him to overly suggestive and sexual content from various female streamers, end quote. To cure the twitch in his pants, the self-proclaimed sex addict reportedly resorted to using a fleshlight to masturbate while watching the salacious gamers, which resulted in him chafing his penis every day.
Fleshlight?
Fleshlight.
Okay. Right.
The plaintiff's randy pastime was extremely painful and caused him redness and mild infection, forced him to use Neosporin on his tip to prevent necrosis.
You gotta worry about the necrosis on the tip there.
Wait, it gets even worse. He alleges in the transcript he even once ejaculated on his PC monitor, which caused his gaming system to short circuit. And it resulted in a fire that temporarily caused his apartment to black out. Twitch said that they were not responsible. I'm reading from the New York Post, by the way, not surprisingly. Despite the ridiculous, they spell that R-I hyphen dick hyphen the rest of the word, allegations, Estavillo claims he can't just find another hobby. The plaintiff's various ailments, which include depression, agoraphobia, Crohn's disease, and OCD, along with sex addiction, have relegated him to surfing the internet in his apartment all day. And Twitch exacerbated his sex addiction because apparently its twisted programming and netcode made it nearly impossible for the plaintiff to use Twitch without being exposed to such sexually suggestive content.
Look, I think we just got to agree that this is an A for creativity in terms of the lawsuit.
Oh, my God. Wait a second. I can't believe. Wait, hold on, Matt. SWU is reportedly following 786 female gamers and zero male ones, many of whom he names in the lawsuit per the doc. So here's what's so important. Ready? As reparations, SWU wants a permanent ban on all listed streamers. And the $25 million in punitive damage, which he says he'll split with other Twitch Turbo subscribers, any leftover proceeds will be donated to both COVID-19 and Black Lives Matter charities and fund worth choosing.
They could get together with that couple in St. Louis.
I was thinking that, yeah.
They should all sit around and injure their...
genitalia for the sake of Black Lives Matter and COVID.
Right. This is like an incel type thing, right?
Incel who wants to donate leftovers to Black Lives Matter and COVID.
I love it. It's like a combination of everything. Yeah, woke incel. That's like a new species, right? You've broken new scientific ground. You discovered a new animal.
You're really going to regret that analogy, that metaphor. You know why?
Why?
Because my final... story.
Is it a fish hook thing?
No, my final penis related story is, and of course, reading again at the New York Post, leech swims up man's penis, drinks pint of blood before docs pull it out. Okay. Now this story, so we've gone from India to California and now we're going to Cambodia. Doctors in Cambodia. Okay, here's a worm that'll make you squirm. Doctors in Cambodia removed a leech that, in wince-worthy fashion, had entered an elderly man's penis while he was swimming and drank a full pint of blood. The unnamed patient first knew something was awry after experiencing severe pain while trying to use the bathroom. He wound up at a hospital in Phnom Penh, where how do you say it? Sorry.
Phnom Penh, I think.
Phnom Penh. In Phnom Penh, where a tiny camera was inserted, where a tiny camera was inserted into his penis, which revealed the culprit to be a leech. The poor soul told doctors, Dan, can we show this, by the way? I just want, because I think Matt needs to, unfortunately.
I need to see this.
Major trigger warning.
My hunger.
Yeah. So, yeah. So there you see the actual leech.
Are those spawn?
Oh my God. What is that though? So we see a big leech and then, I don't know. Is that spawn or is that like the leech broken or is that blood? I mean, it's so disgusting. Also, a pint is like your regular regular ice cream unit, right?
Yes, I love that you make an ice cream metaphor here.
I mean, because, right? Yeah. Well, as we all know, Chubby Hubby. Now we can make a new flavor called lychee.
Yeah, peachy lychee or something like
peachy,
that, right?
Lychee, yeah.
Yeah.
Or lychee nuts.
Lychee nuts, yes.
Oh, my God.
Oh, perfect.
Perfect,
Katie,
right?
High five, right?
Very COVID good. High five, yeah. And then there's another, if you scroll down, because the first one is like black and white, you don't really see it, but this one, we actually see it. Oh my God, it's so gross. If you close that and then click on the next one, you'll see the doctor. So in this photo, that's ridiculous.
From the moon landing or something like that, right?
Yeah, in that photo.
The guy is giving the thumbs up.
Yeah, yeah, they're posing. So this is a medical team. They're a bunch of doctors, and they're all giving the thumbs up. And they have, it says, doctors pose with the bladder invading bloodsucker. And then, unfortunately, removal was complicated by the fact that the interloper had ballooned up to a much larger size after sucking a pint of the victim's blood, hence his pain while urinating. This is really disgusting. I really am disgusted. I'm sorry, everyone. Not only that, but it had already injured parts of the man's organs with its teeth. To safely extract the vial, visitor, doctors were forced to use a teeny probe with electric nodes and cutting tools at the end to kill the leech before yanking it back out the way it came in. Fortunately, the man was released from the hospital after spending the night there. Just the night? Jesus. And is said to be faring okay after the skin crawling ordeal. This isn't the first time a leech has infiltrated an unlikely orifice. In 2018, a video surfaced of a blood-sucking worm being pulled out of a man's nose.
The subtext of the story is just, don't go swimming in Cambodia, right?
Yeah.
So I think no. And the other thing I love is photo of all those dudes who did the procedure.
Yeah, with the thumbs up.
Because they're all like kind of smiling, like they have this kind of this devilish grin that they're sort of suppressing on their faces, which is every man who hears this news story is going to involuntarily have the same thoughts, and that I don't know. There's some sort of brotherhood of dudes in that picture. That's kind of funny. Wow. Right. Well, that was weird. Could have been terrible too.
I think they all survived, I guess. So
yeah. So that's good. Yeah. There we go. I have multiple stories as well, but I'm just going to institute a new policy here.
You did this to me. I'm already looking at the headline.
Don't look at the headlines.
All right.
Don't look at the headlines.
I didn't know I wasn't supposed to. Okay, well, I'm not looking.
All right, pick a letter between A and C.
B.
B? All right. This is from The Guardian. Horror scene in Canada after 38 dead puppies found on plane. Canada has launched an investigation after some 500 puppies. 38 of them dead were found on board a Ukraine International Airlines plane at the Toronto airport, officials said Saturday. The surviving French bulldogs, a popular breed in Canada, were suffering from symptoms including dehydration, weakness, and vomiting when they were found on the flight from Ukraine that landed at Toronto Pearson Airport on 13 June, the Canadian Food Inspection Agency said in a statement. The agency, quote, will determine next steps once the investigation is complete, it said. So dead puppies, that's what this story is. And
what the hell? Why?
Because they packed a whole bunch of puppies into a plane, didn't take care of them. And you know, when they got to Toronto, they had lost a whole bunch of them. And here's the insincere corporate apology, which is a staple of this sort of story. UIA, the Ukrainian airline, offered its, quote, condolences for the tragic loss of animal life on our flight, end quote, and said on Facebook that it was working with local authorities. I don't know how much you want to believe that Ukrainian Airlines didn't know that 500 puppies were being loaded into one of its planes, but all right, well, dead puppies in Canada.
That is so sad.
Yeah, it is.
There was potentially some organized crime component.
There was, yes.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, puppies go for this breed goes for $3,000 or $4,000 a puppy, so that's quite a lot of money.
That is so heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Like, wow.
I'm sure that there's about 1,000 of those stories happen every day, but this is one that just happened to hit the news. So anyway, that's terrible, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Although I think your penis stories were all.
I know. I mean, I almost feel like we could have reversed them, and that could have been weird.
It could have been. It could have been. But that's a typical thing with this feature of ours. But we're comfortable with that. All right. Should we talk news of the week? I don't know if it was great, but it was certainly circulated quite a bit. So have you read White Fragility?
I'm afraid that if I read it, it'll be too, I won't be able to take it.
You'll retreat from your.
Yeah, I'll recoil from it, and I'll just become that much more attached to my privilege.
Mm-hmm.
I'll leave the habitat of.
Habitus.
Habitus, right. The habitus, yeah. Blancus.
Right.
In which I already currently reside.
You'll retreat from the disquiet in your habitus.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
And from this, abandon the stress inducing situation. That's one of her phrases.
The SIS. SIS, yeah.
So for folks who aren't familiar with. Oh my God, I did it.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Is there a penalty box?
Do we have a box and a folks box.
Yeah, it's not quite a flagrant two, but
right, it's a single.
Yeah, a second flagrant is a time is an ejection for sure.
Yeah.
All right. So no more use of that word, or else I'm gonna be out of the game.
Yeah.
Yeah, and maybe even suspended next week.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, that's important. So I'm on notice.
Your folk band.
Yeah, that's right.
Folk band like Peter, Paul, and Mary.
Wow. Wait. Why are they banned? Oh, folk band. Oh, I see.
That was in real time, people.
I will say, too, if the Overton window comes up, that's an instant ejection.
Yeah.
And a fine.
And a fine, yeah. And you donate that to not Black Lives Matter or COVID, but to the Fleshlight Fund.
The Fleshlight Fund. So White Fragility is the number one book, at least it was last week, was the number one selling book in the country. This corporate consultant, Robin DiAngelo, has written this book that is just taking America by storm because in the wake of the George Floyd incident, white Americans want to know what they can do to repair and end racism. And so this book is flying off the shelves. Now, there's massive irony already in the fact that the book that surges to the top of the bestseller list because white people want to deal with racism is a book by another white person.
Right.
But.
And I wonder how much money she's making off of it and how much of that goes to causes.
I have no idea. Apparently her consultant fees. Now to understand the background here,
yeah,
Robin DiAngelo works as a corporate consultant for companies typically that have had some kind of toxicity complaint. Right. So, they bring in a team of diversity experts who come in and conduct these trainings and they facilitate anti-racism training, and they have people come in and they have to do these seminars, and she charges massive amounts of money to companies. And it's this great.
Do you know her rate? Does anyone know her rates?
This is a tweet from Thomas Chatterton Williams who was commenting about this.
Well, we should have on the show.
Yeah, we should. He's like, everybody's got to work, and there are plenty of writers who get tens of thousands of dollars for a 45-minute talk. And yet, there really is a preposterous irony at play when a white woman makes $6,000 per hour by insisting to other whites that they are all privileged, racist and privileged. So, yeah, Robin DiAngelo, she makes lots and lots of money basically explaining to people, you know, the sort of causes of racism. And the fundamental theory about her book is that everybody is basically defined by their racial category. It's inescapable. Racism is everywhere. It's in every transaction. It's in every conversation. It can't be denied. If you deny it, that's actually more proof of your white fragility. So it's sort of like the ordeal by water. You know, if you throw the witch in the water, if it sinks, it's a witch. If it floats, it's a witch.
So if you deny it, you're really racist. And if you own that if you cop to being racist, you're a racist.
Yeah, then you have to commit to a lifelong program. Right. Right. And then she says in the book that there can be no positive self-image for whiteness. The best that you can aspire to is to try to aspire to be less white.
Right. Well, then she must be a real fan of Rachel Dolezal, because that's what she did, right?
Right. Yeah. So that's confusing. She has some ideas about what actually is whiteness, and yeah. She speaks in there that about the nature of how you define it. It's not a biological thing. But the amazing thing about Robin DiAngelo is that fundamentally, a lot of her beliefs are very similar to what you would find on the complete opposite, theoretically, end of the spectrum. So in that spirit, I want to play a little game.
Okay.
And this is going to be called Richard Spencer.
Ooh.
Or Robin DiAngelo.
Who said it, Richard Spencer or Robin DiAngelo? I like that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're going to have some quotes here, and I want you to try to guess who said what. Of course, for people who don't know, Richard Spencer is a sort of notorious, probably, would you say he's America's leading notorious open racist?
Yeah, white supremacist.
White supremacist,
yeah.
Identitarian. All right, racist isn't a descriptive word, it's a pejorative word. It's the equivalent of saying, I don't like you. Racist is just a slur word. I think race is real, and I think race is important. And those two principles do not mean I want to harm someone or hate someone.
Oh, Spencer.
Okay, that's Spencer. The final challenge we need to address is our definition of racist. In the post-civil rights era, we've been taught that racists are mean people who intentionally dislike others because of their race. Racists are immoral. Therefore, I'm saying that if my readers are racist, that my readers are racist, or even worse, that all white people are racist, I am saying something deeply offensive. I am questioning my readers' very moral character.
Well, that gives it away because the readers, right? Because he hasn't written that much stuff. So, Robin.
That is Robin. But if you'll take note, that's essentially the same idea. They both believe that one of the problems in society is that we have defined racist as being a negative word, where we should just be accepting that it exists,
right.
and embrace what its meaning is.
Right. But she's saying like it's an appropriate word, get over it, where he's saying it's not appropriate. You're not racist. Like, she's like, everyone's a racist, and no one's a racist.
No, he's saying that racist is an okay thing to be.
But he's saying it's okay, but he's also saying he's complaining that it's a slur. I see. Right. Is he embracing it?
Yes.
Yes, he is. All right.
He's saying that we should be proud to be racist.
Right. And she's saying you should be ashamed. You're all racist, and you should be ashamed. Okay. All white people are racist. Okay.
There's an additional quote from her on that score. Still, I don't feel guilty about racism.
I would say Spencer.
Nope, that's DiAngelo.
Whoa, wait, say it again.
Still, I don't feel guilty about racism.
And she's saying that, or is she quoting another white person?
She's saying that.
Really?
Yes.
She needs to go back and read White Fragility then.
No, she's saying that we should, her point is that we should just accept that we all are racists and just deal with it.
Right, I see.
Okay, unlike heavy feelings such as guilt, the continuous work of identifying my internalized superiority and how it may be manifesting itself is incredibly liberating.
DiAngelo?
That is DiAngelo, okay. Yeah. White identity largely rests on a foundation of superficial racial tolerance and acceptance. We whites who position ourselves as liberal often opt to protect what we perceive as our moral reputations.
DiAngelo.
That is DiAngelo.
Because he wouldn't say he's liberal, yeah.
Yeah, but otherwise, if the word liberal wasn't in there, that would be a tough one.
Can you say it again without the liberal?
white identity largely rests on a foundation of superficial racial tolerance and acceptance. We whites often opt to protect what we perceive as our moral reputations.
Yeah, see, if you had just taken that thing out, I could have struggled.
Right. People who claim not to be prejudiced are demonstrating a profound lack of self-awareness. Ironically, they are also demonstrating the power of socialization. We have all been taught in schools, through movies, and from family members, teachers, and clergy that it is important not to be prejudiced. Unfortunately, the prevailing belief that prejudice is bad causes us to deny its unavoidable reality.
That's kind of close, and I almost said Spencer, but I'm going to say D'Angelo.
It is D'Angelo, yeah. So you'll notice that the giveaways in all this are essentially mostly lingual. The ideas are really, really similar. And what they're both saying in different ways is that race is the defining characteristic of society, that we have to stop running from that, that we have to embrace that, that we have to abandon, the hypocritical and unrealistic goal of diversity and common humanity, and we have to just sort of learn to deal with each other as racially motivated people. And the thing that's weird about this is that if you read D'Angelo's book, there are so many moments in there that are like giveaways about how it seems that she has some serious issues with race, and that maybe she is projecting onto the rest of us. Like, here's a quote from the book that I thought was fascinating. There is a curious satisfaction in the punishment of black people, smiling faces of the white crowd picnicking at lynchings in the past, and the satisfied approval of white people observing mass incarceration and execution in the present. White righteousness, when inflicting pain on African Americans, is evident in the glee the white collective derives from blackface and depictions of blacks as apes and gorillas. Who is she hanging around with, right?
Yeah.
Here's another one. We see white solidarity at the dinner table, at parties, and at work settings. Many of us can relate to the big family dinner at which Uncle Bob says something racially offensive. Everyone cringes, but no one challenges him because no one wants to ruin the dinner. Or the party where someone tells a racist joke, but we keep silent because we don't want to be accused of being too politically correct and be told to lighten up.
I mean, I think it's kind of weird that she kind of uses those examples as if they're comparable.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You know what I mean? Like, those are pretty different things.
Right.
Not disrupting, quote unquote, disrupting racism versus being gleeful about blackface and violence.
Yeah, or and cheering on depictions of blacks as apes and gorillas. Like, I struggle to remember an instance of any of these things, really, in my personal experience. But
right.
she seems to think that it's happening quite a lot, and it's a very, very strange book. And what's really odd about it is that it's being recommended basically across the board by people who think it's a sort of uncontroversial work that is instructing white people to confront, their own racist history, the structural inequities of the country, which would all be very positive things, but it comes gift wrapped in this package that is really bizarre and quite radical, where essentially there are only three categories of people. There's people of color, there's allies, and then there's people who are white supremacists, essentially.
Right.
And if you deny the that logic, you are contributing to white supremacy. And
did you read the whole book, by the way?
I did, yes.
I mean, my biggest problem with this, and we'll probably discuss this with our guests, I'm assuming, is that it actually doesn't really do anything to challenge any structural racism. The entire theater for this is on the personal level.
Exactly. I don't think it's a coincidence that this person is a corporate consultant.
Right.
It identifies a problem that can be handled, and the way she describes it, it can be handled as an HR matter.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
All interpersonal. But the thing that really troubles me about this is that it overprescribes in order to avoid the actual structural critique. It goes a million miles in this other direction and creates this possibility for whereby corporations can endlessly root out, you know, signs of the never completely suppressed white supremacy. Because one of the theories of this book is that it cannot be eradicated. There's no possible future where we can all sort of just get along. So you need constant
vigilance.
But her prescription, you basically need lots and lots of people like Robin DiAngelo to constantly hunt out evidence of this kind of behavior. Also, and isn't that convenient for that $6,000 an hour or whatever
it is? Isn't that convenient? Isn't that terrible?
And I mentioned this in the piece that even if all we're going to get in terms of, you know, racial reform or anti-racist activism is a whole bunch of these folks hired by corporations, there will be some positive side effects. Oh no, I'm in the penalty box. But you know, they will correct inequities in hiring, like the boardrooms will become more representative and all that, but they probably, right? I would think.
Yeah, they will.
But the problem that, as I see it, is that she's training people to view themselves as being defined by their race and to be hyper conscious of it in all their interactions with other people. And I think it's exactly the opposite. And she denigrates Martin Luther King's "I Have a Dream" speech in the book, and talks about how the moment of where he said, you know, I have a dream where we will someday be judged not by the color of my skin, but by the content of our character, right? Our children.
That fame. Yeah. Does she denigrate him, or does she denigrate the way people, because I haven't read it, but does she denigrate his speech, or does she denigrate the way people use it or respond to it?
She doesn't denigrate him per se, but she talks about it in a way that is highly dismissive. And she takes takes this completely ungenerous interpretation of why that speech was embraced by white people, right? In other words, like the only reason that people embraced that speech is because it gave us an out, right? Now all we had to do is pretend that racism didn't exist, and you know, pretend to get along with one another. And whereas, you know, again, I just think it's kind of a radical thing to abandon this idea that maybe there's a future goal or that we could work toward.
Right. There's a difference between saying we live in a colorblind society or we live in a post-racial society and aspiring towards that.
Exactly. Yeah. And she's explicitly rejecting the aspirational.
It's so funny because I would love for her to read other Martin Luther King texts and try to grapple with them. Because what's absent from all of this stuff is any discussion of kind of where these things hit up against other things like class or like international issues. Like, if you care about racism, what about imperialism? But of course, this is all the very personal individual. Can we read some of your stuff? I can read it if you don't feel comfortable, because some of it's really funny. All right, so you write, DiAngelo's writings, and this is a piece you wrote at Substack called On White Fragility, A Few Thoughts on America's Smash Hit Number One Guide to Egghead Racialism. And you write, DiAngelo instructs us, there's nothing nothing to be done here except strive to be less white. To deny this theory or to have the effrontery to sneak away from the tedium of DiAngelo's lecturing, what she describes as leaving the stress-inducing situation, is to affirm her conception of white supremacy. This intellectual equivalent of ordeal by water, if you float, you're a witch, is orthodoxy across much of academia. DiAngelo's writing style is pure pain. The lexicon favored by intersectional theorists of this type is built around the same principles as Orwell's Newspeak. It banishes ambiguity, nuance, and feeling, and structures itself around sterile word pairs like racist and anti-racist, platform and deplatform, center and silence, that reduce all thinking to a series of binary choices. Ironically, Donald Trump does something similar, only with words like amazing and sad that are simultaneously more childish and livelier. Big, important point. Writers like DiAngelo like to make ugly verbs out of ugly nouns and ugly nouns out of ugly verbs. There are countless permutations on centering and privileging alone. In a world where only a few ideas are considered important, redundancy is encouraged, e.g., quote, to be less white is to break with white silence and white solidarity, to stop privileging the comfort of white people. Or Ruth Frankenberg, a premier white scholar in the field of whiteness, describes whiteness as multidimensional. I like this part. D'Angelo writes like a person who was put in timeout as a child for speaking clearly. When there is disequilibrium in the habitus, when social cues are unfamiliar and or when they challenge our capital, we use strategies to regain our balance, she says. People taken out of their comfort zones find ways to deal, according to Google Translate. Ideas that go through the English D'Angelo translator usually end up significantly altered.
A lot of her language is like that. It sort of sounds like meaningless gibberish where there's supposed to be this, some kind of subtext underneath, but there's no subtext. She just literally means what she says, and right. it doesn't make any sense. I mean, people are coming around to criticizing it a little bit, but yeah. I think if you actually read it, you'd find it deeply disturbing.
We should probably do a reading, like a sentence or a paragraph every week.
Yeah, well, to help facilitate our anti-racist training.
Yeah.
All right, well, we have a great interview coming up.
So excited to have on Adolph Reed, Professor Emeritus at UPenn. He's a political scientist, and he's also was a big Bernie person, so I want to give him a shout out there. He is the founder of the site nonsite.org, which is a great, really interesting intellectual leftist publication. He's also involved in the Debs Jones Douglas Institute and South Carolina Medicare for All.
In short, a Renaissance figure, lots of different interests and intellect, and let's see what he has to say.
Just wanted to explain to our Useful Idiots listeners that during this interview, Professor Adolph Reed's virtual Zoom background was a photo of North Carolina Tar Heels championship banners. Of course, I was immediately aware of the significance of that. Totally know who Tar Heels are and North Carolina Tar Heels. Okay, so enjoy.
How you doing?
Hi, how are you?
Hey,
how are you doing,
good.
Professor? Love this background.
Oh, very nice.
Oh, wow.
That is great.
All I have to say is suck it, Duke.
That's the whole interview right there.
Yeah.
we don't even need to move on from there. who's your most hated Duke basketball player from the year?
Oh my God, how much time do you have?
We got a lot of time.
Well, you can't miss with Christian Laettner.
Christian Laettner is a great one.
Bobby Hurley, who always struck me as like the kind of guy who was so who was operating so much on the edge of his talent and his emotional capacity.
That's true.
that like every Thanksgiving, I expected to hear he went home and killed his fucking family. I'm Jersey, too. Oh, what was the guy? Paulus.
Greg Paulus, I think is
the guy. Right? Yeah, Greg. I've got a great photo of Danny Green dunking over him. And I mean... literally, right? Green's crotch was about 6 inches over Paulus's head when he threw down.
All right, we should get started, I guess.
Yeah, okay. Right? Well, I just want to say again, face to face, that that the Robin DiAngelo thing made my week, man. That was great.
Yeah. I'm glad.
And I mentioned to my son that you made the Hitler reference, because this is what we've been saying about the way that these people talk about race, right? I mean... We've seen where this train goes, and you might think there's some other spur, but eventually this motherfucker is going to wind up in Auschwitz, right?
Yeah.
Right. Well, can we expand on that a little bit? Because I'm relatively new to reading this kind of literature, so I don't read it at all.
So I mean,
okay.
But I've read enough snippets of that stuff, and in fact, my son just had to sit through a training on the stuff at his university yesterday. So it was like Zoom and a lot of it. And like, he only learned the borderland trope like when he was in graduate school. So it was around the time that the borderland thing was like leaving. But the professional race relations consultants use it now too. So it's like all this stuff. But no, I mean, the conversation we've been having about this is pretty straightforward, that racism is the belief that races exist. Punto.
Right.
Fin.
Right.
Nada más. Right. I mean, and so if you insist that race is real, which apparently more and more of the people who are coming at the likes of us as class reductionists insist, they're a racist. Mm-hmm. Right. Well, but in the literal sense, right?
Because they're stressing it, race over other factors?
Or? Not just because they're stressing it, but mm-hmm. that they insist that we treat it as an essentialist category right. that's rooted either in biology or culture dressed up as biology, or mm-hmm. biology dressed up as culture, because they really come out to be the same thing. So it's not, and what people typically, you know, think or want to think is that racism is the belief that some races are better than others, and some should be persecuted by those that are better. But what they have a lot of trouble wrapping their minds around is, and I've taught this, you know, for decades, that no, racism is the belief that there is some subspecific naturally occurring right. population within Homo sapiens that exists between the level of the species and the local breeding population.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And those are called races, and I've often said to people, every time you hear the word race, think unicorn, because it's the same thing. Right.
right. But it's right. also, and the same people who have that kind of implicitly in their understanding, they talk about race as a social construction.
Right.
But they don't actually view it that way.
Yeah, no, it's like doing like that, right?
Yeah.
Oh, race is a social construction.
Right. And genuflecting, yeah.
Right, yeah,
just
exactly.
Listening and not viewing, yeah. Aren't you impressed by what a good, for secular Jew, how fluent I am in that theology thing?
Totally. No, absolutely am. Yeah, they have it with the genuflect. That's great.
One of the things we wanted to get into with that, though, is this mode of thinking, is it utilitarian? Is it just convenient for instance, I mean, part of my thinking about this is that corporate America would much rather engage with the subject in this way than deal with much broader and more difficult questions. And so right. they're hiring these people and encouraging this kind of research in universities and, yeah. Or is it something else? I'm genuinely curious.
I think the most crystallizing things that I've heard you say or read you say is that identity politics are class politics.
Yeah.
Which I think also relates to Matt's question
right.
about what the function right. of this is. So.
Well, yeah, no, and that's kind of where I was going. That well, one of the things my dad often said, in fact, he said it a lot, is that from one perspective, ideology is the mechanism that harmonizes the principles that you want to think you hold and what advances your material interests, right? So from that perspective, it's like hard to sort out. I mean, we have a natural tendency to want to do it because we want to know who's an asshole and who's not, but it's hard to sort out what's genuine and what's not, because my dad would often also follow up by saying that sincerity is vastly overrated as a virtue. He said, you know, Himmler was sincere. Like, he sincerely yeah. thought that the world would be better with no Jews and Gypsies and Slavs in it. So what kind of points do we give him for that, for the sincerity of his belief, right? So it's hard to say. And I mean, that's kind of the way that ideology works. And that's kind of, and I think that one of the challenges that faces, to whatever extent it still makes any sense whatsoever to use a word like left, but one of the challenges that faces us as a left is to get beyond the tendency to read history as being made up of good people and bad people. And boy, this is a hell of a moment to suggest that, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And to sort of think about the relation between the past and the present from a perspective of trying to help us understand how we got to this screwed up situation that we're in now. And what's the Upton Sinclair quip? It's very difficult to get a man to believe something when his livelihood depends on him not believing it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are a lot of things that people believe because they believe them, right? And that's like folk wisdom, right? And you can tell it's coming, you know, when people say things like, well, I know that the evidence shows this, but I'm just convinced that there's this other thing. And he said, well, yeah, you're convinced that there's this other thing because you had an a priori sense that it was there, right? But it's a reification. It's in your head. It's not some shit that's in, sorry, something that's in the world, right? But now, see, at this point, and And I was actually just trying to write a little bit about this before the call, that that we've got now like a half century of emergence of an industry that's anchored to race relations engineering, right? So people believe it. It makes sense for them to believe it. And as to your point about corporations preferring to deal with it, I think your position just got, 1.7 billion votes right over the last couple of weeks, right, from Uber and fucking Bezos and Popeye's Chicken, for God's sake. I mean, I was waiting for Colt 45 malt liquor, like a St. Ides, to pony up a couple hundred million. That's a part of the problem, right, because there is a political economy of identity group relations, right? And it's, centered largely in the cultural sector. It's like all up and down the professional managerial strata. By this point too, I mean, I've written this about, the current black political class. So 50 years after the Voting Rights Act, 50 years plus after the Voting Rights Act, you would expect that black political class, after all these years of their holding the same jobs, going to the same schools, multi-generationally, kids going to the same schools, kids playing on the same traveling soccer teams, having sleepovers, going to one another's weddings, marrying one another, consuming the same stuff, going to the same restaurants, that they're like a single class, right? And yeah, there's like pigmentation differences in it, sort of depending on where you are, but what people want to see as a racial perspective on the world is much more likely to be a class perspective, right? But the work that an issue like mass incarceration does, or police violence does, and I'm not suggesting for a second that a Yale graduate investment banker who is black doesn't have a greater likelihood of being pushed face down on the platform of Metro North than his white classmate by a transit cop. But that same person doesn't have anywhere near the same chance of being jacked up in that way as somebody that lived in a zip code that George Floyd lived in. But the work that taking issues or like stressing issues like mass incarceration or police violence as concerns that in principle at least affect all people of color or all black people, the work that focus does is basically the same that the focus or the insistence on analogizing inequalities or injustices in the present to slavery and to Jim Crow, which is that it denies the existence of political differentiation, of economic differentiation, of class differentiation among black people, and insists on a simplistic one color frame, race, basically, right? I mean, one lens through which to see everything. So in essence, it's ultimately a pretty crude class program. And the kind of frightening thing about the current moment, and I've been thinking about this for a while and didn't want to say it out loud, but I can count on Thomas Byrne Edsel to say things I wouldn't want to say out loud, but in the wrong way. But from the standpoint of the capitalist class, right, or the ruling class, I've been thinking that what appeals to them about this identitarian moment is that it can offer a way to rescue something that looks like a democratic neoliberalism, that is a small d, in a context in which it may be as the combination of the Sanders insurgencies and the Trump insurgency showed, that your neoliberal political economy, it may be exhausting its capacities for delivering enough stuff to enough people to be able to keep functioning as a democracy. And I mean, we see what's happened like in other states that have gotten to that point, Brazil, Bolivia, Hungary, India, Poland, et cetera. I mean, I would toss Boris Johnson in there too, just for the heck of it. So what I was thinking was, okay, well then if they can help consolidate, the idea that the only serious and morally defensible norm for social justice is anti-disparitarianism, right? Or pursuit of equality, a real equality of opportunity in market capitalism, then it can keep the thing going for a while. But the 30 thought underneath that is that, you know, as Edsall and Michael Lind and Joel Kotkin and people like that are always going to look for, that this attention that's being lavished, right, on the colors, as it were, fuels counter mobilization among the authoritarian right. And I thought, okay, well, maybe, you know, that could be a problem that the real ruling class figures they can handle. But on the other hand, like, it might be that works out pretty well for them too, right? And this is a way that I've been toying with the notion that anti-racism now may come to perform the a version of the same kind of function that racism performed for the first half or two-thirds of the 20th century, depending on where you were in the U.S. Boy, that was a long-winded response.
No, but I mean, in terms of the same function, though, but by dividing and preventing a broader focus on other structural issues, right? I mean, because I was really struck by your diagnosis of the reaction to Trump's election, because I had a lot of the same thoughts and wasn't able to really articulate them all that well. But I remember there was this moment when the journalists who were following Trump, it was like it all happened. It felt like almost instantaneously. There was a moment where it was suddenly decided that the only explanation for Trump was this white identity politics that all of his voters, including as you pointed out, the ones who voted for Barack Obama, that they were all driven by this. It was hopeless, and this pessimism sort of led to a lack of inquisitiveness about what had actually happened in 2016. And I just wondered if you could talk about a little bit about that, because you're one of the few people I've seen who's really dug into this issue.
That's pretty scary, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
because there ought to be a lot more. It should be a lot more obvious. I mean, there's a lot going on there, right? I mean, one of the things is that, you know, our class, broadly speaking, are the people who live the most segregated lives in America,
mm-hmm.
right? Their workplaces are the most segregated. Their neighborhoods are the most segregated. And they need a way to feel better than trashy white people out there. Right.
Right.
They perceive it. Right. So they displace all of the stuff that they don't like to think about themselves onto those people. So that's part of it. So, I mean, they're kind of set. Right. I mean, the default for the people who read the New York Times is kind of set on the conviction that these trashy fat people out there are like stupid and bigoted and so forth and so on.
And deserve their own misery.
Oh, yeah. No. Well, and see, that's the beauty of human capital, isn't it? Right? Because if they had just paid attention in school,
right,
and gone to MIT, right, they wouldn't be dependent on that job that Bill Clinton shipped to China.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Right. Learn to code.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And by the way, you know, a lot of people have forgotten the earlier incarnation of Robert Reich in the Clinton administration, haven't they? Because he was the guy who was telling us to go do that, right? Like, mm-hmm. we were all going to be symbolic analysts, where all the shitty jobs are going to go to Mexico.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to see him get up on his stool and explain that one now. But anyway, I mean, that's right. And that is the work that, that human capital discourse does, but it does it like on both sides of the racial curtain too, right? Because the underclass are people who the difference between liberals and conservatives, right, about broke black people and brown people, and white people for that matter, is that the liberals say, well, they're broke through reasons that don't have to do with their own intrinsic they're broke, but they're fucked up for reasons that don't have to do with their own intrinsic failings, but they're victims and in principle, maybe kind of weak because they couldn't stand up to it or didn't have the skills or whatever, whatever. Where the conservatives say, no, they're just terrible. But they both agree on the terrible part, right? And that they're a problem to be administered, right? They can't be trusted to take care of themselves. They don't really deserve a decent standard of living, right? For whatever reason. I was saying to somebody, and this may have been a thing I did with Bhaskar, but because we got into talking about the island and political history. And I mentioned, yeah, like I spent, you know, once it became clear what Reagan was, then I figured, okay, then I need to spend most of my time trying to figure out how to talk to liberals and make common ground with them. But then finally, when the underclass thing hit by the end of the 80s, and like all of the liberals went with it and they started calling this a left politics, right? And the left politics was publicly beating up on the most vulnerable people in the society, people who never have access to a public microphone. I said, okay, well, fuck it, I can't do this anymore, right? But that's what it's been since then. So we've been living now, for however you want to count it, in a sort of bipartisan neoliberal consensus that was formed and consolidated somewhere between Reagan, the elder Bush, and Clinton. And it might be that the Obama presidency was the last hurrah for that version of democratic small d again, neoliberalism. But like now, I mean, God knows what the other side of the pandemic's going to be. But I'm starting to feel now that the ruling class, or the people that count, right, the opinion leaders, as political scientists would call them, have decided to weigh in and to put their thumbs on the scales in ways that are characteristically left in form and right in essence, right? So,
like what? I'm sorry to interrupt, but
well, like the race relations stuff, right? Yeah, I'm not naive about the function of neoliberal police. Like, you know, the first time I saw the Battle of Algiers in a movie theater, I thought, shit, I've been in this movie, right? I mean, and when my son got swept up by a black cop with a jerry curl, when he was 15 in New Haven, Connecticut, on the way home from high school, once I subsided blowing my top, when I found out about it a little bit, I said to him, well, I guess you just had your black bar mitzvah, right? So it's like,
mazel tov, yeah.
Right? Yeah, exactly. So I'm not naive about that, but I also understand that most black people, most of the time, and I mean most working class black people, don't wake up first thing in the morning thinking about the cops. They're thinking about stuff like jobs, housing, healthcare, schools. I mean, how are they going to pay for it? How are they going to get it? You know, whatever, whatever. But the issues, like, you know, abstract moral issue, like police reform as an abstraction, defunding the police as an abstraction, breaking police unions / public sector unions as a concrete proposal, works out very nicely for them, right? And it also changes the topic. And I got to admit, like, I was no fan of Occupy or like the rest of that stuff, but I wasn't even prepared for how quickly you know, the street action went from defunding the police department to pulling down a Lincoln statue. You know what I mean? I mean, so this is just the kind of bread and circuses stuff that appeals to the other side. And you can feel the long hand of the Ford Foundation and the leadership development and community development corporations and like shaping the institutional structure of a political economy of race relations administration that sort of moves in a slightly different direction, farther away from anything that smells like class redistribution.
Well, I want to ask about that because the people who are the sort of opinion leaders, one of the things they're really great at is creating names for things that villainize ideas, yeah. Right? And so when the response to what you were talking about, which was let's focus on sort of systemic class issues, income inequality, that sort of stuff, they came up with this name class reductionism, right? And you've been very critical of that. Could you talk about how that term came to being and what it means and what your thoughts are about it?
Yeah, sure. Well, I mean, I suspect that its historical roots go back to the debates in the fragmentation of SDS in the late 1960s, where people were throwing charges around at one another. But the recent iteration, I think, is, well, okay, no, a couple things happened, right? First is the class versus race debate. Which one is it? And then we respond by saying, well, that's a simplistic debate because of a variety of reasons we can talk about later if you want, I don't know. But like then this kind of funny position started to pop up around DSA and like other younger leftist groups or whatever called it's been satirized by its opponents as both andism, right? That it's like race and class. And say, yeah, okay, well, that's great, fine. So what does that mean exactly? But then the next move is, all right, so Katie, I'm sure is probably implicated like at the heart of this, but so like Sanders gets castigated as a class reductionist because he talks about the working class. And one of the rhetorical moves here is that working class gets redefined as white. So you can't be black and be in a working class, even though statistically speaking, not to be a prude about this, you're more likely to be in a working class if you're black than if you're white, right? I mean, just given who does what for a living and like the distribution of jobs. But you can't be. So you can either be black or working class. You can't be both. And to me, like, that's first of all a testament of the extent to which the black upper class and a professional managerial strata have won in defining what's publicly understood to be the domain of black political aspiration. Right. Joy-Ann Reid is kind of a pet of mine, like in this regard. Right. In fact, just before I hit the Zoom link, right, I checked her annual salary and her net worth because I just happened to see her on a Daily Show in 2017, ragging on Bernie and explaining about how black people don't really care about stuff like Medicare for all or free college or universally redistributive programs, but they want stuff like they want to have the racial conversation and to have the reckoning about America's past. And I thought, gee, I wonder what black people she's been talking to. Mm-hmm. And then I double checked and saw she's a Harvard graduate. She made then like $1.5 million a year and had a net worth of $4 million. So I'm pretty sure that the black circles that she runs in don't include a lot of people who would say, oh, wow, I can go to Penn State for free. Right? So that's one thing that's going on. So,
and you know, she just got promoted, by the way. I don't know if you know this news. She's going to take over Chris Matthews' spot at 7 p.m. weekdays.
Wow. Seriously?
So she's prime time. Yeah.
Wow. Uh-huh. So ching ching.
Yeah.
Well.
Oh, no. She famous. It's funny. You talked about free college and Joy-Ann Reid. And of course, one of my favorite tweets of hers was when she compared Bernie Sanders to your college friend, roommate who doesn't pay rent and stays on your couch. Which is just so funny because I'm so loath to play the anti-Semitic card or anti-Semite card.
Right, right.
But like the double standard and the sensitivity that's demanded from people in one direction and is not at all even considered in the other one. I'm just like, are you kidding? Her contempt. And she used to call him the moral voice of the Democratic Party. I don't know what happened though.
Opportunity.
Wow.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, that's funny because on the Bernie thing, I mean, yeah, every time I heard somebody say shrill, oh, really?
Yeah. Or she called him, she referred to his physicality.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And had a body language expert on.
Right. Yeah. You know what? I saw that. And that's one of the most ridiculous things I've seen in my life. Right. I mean, that was like a Mel Brooks skit.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that's crazy. But so anyway, as my friend Walter Ben Michaels has said, the best way you can, or the best evidence that somebody has a class position is that they deny they have one.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Right. And that's how this thing works, right? So you dress what's a class position up in racial garb. And isn't that what nationalism always was, right? I mean, to begin with, right? So then you get to denounce, you know, anybody who has a different class position as a, who, or who's advocating for a different class perspective as a class reductionist. When what gets constituted as the racial agenda is pretty clearly a class agenda, right?
Mm.
What is the racial wealth gap, for God's sake, right? I mean, that's what, I mean, that's not something that's going to dribble down as far as me, you know what I mean? I mean, it's what you rectify the racial wealth gap by creating black investment banking houses, right? That's what the story is. But it's all within commitment to market criteria, or tying a notion and any notion, even just the imagination of a just world, has to be tied to presumptions of a market society.
I saw you, it was really such a great talk. It was, I guess, on the for the Bellows, and you and Walter Ben.
Oh, yeah. Michael, yeah, it was kind of fun.
Yeah, it was great. And you said, you guys were talking about, like, the limits of disparity discourse and also mm-hmm. of disproportionate framing. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, sure. Well, I mean, yeah, like the thing, well, yeah, I mean, the thing about, the disparitarian model or anti-disparitarian model of social justice, right, is that you can fulfill it if 1% of the population controls 90% of the resources, just so long as 12% at 1% is black and 14% is Latino, as half women and
LGBTQ.
Yeah. So that's, in principle, right, like in an ethics course, that's an ideal of social justice that's as good as any other, but it's not the one I'm going to fight for,
right?
And it is one that presumes capitalist market forces, right? And I mean, just to amplify on that for a second, my friend Preston Smith II is a political scientist, did a great book called Racial Democracy in the Black Metropolis. That's a study of post-war housing policy in Chicago, formulated a number of years ago the notion that there have been two contending principles or norms that drove Black American political activity in the middle decades of the 20th century, from the 30s through the 60s. One he defines as the principle of racial democracy, which is basically that, right? I mean, it's the idea that the society will be racially just, as one preacher back in the Black Power era put it, if black people are 12% of the ditch diggers and 12% of the corporate boards, right? And 12% of everything in between. The other, which emerged in black politics out of the Great Migration and the CIO and A. Philip Randolph and the emergence of a black mass politics, is a social democratic ideal. And through the 30s and 40s and 50s and into the 60s, during a period when there's a kind of a black popular front, leftism was dominant, the two kind of rode together and converged and diverged sometimes, ran parallel, right? Sometimes they were in conflict. And I think a simple way to understand what's happened over the last 55 years after the Voting Rights Act is that the racial democratic impulse, which was the one class's impulse, crushed the other one, right? Or sort of ate the twin in the womb or whatever, right? But so now, like, even the vestiges, right, or the symbols of mass action politics that were, you know, like the March on Washington was the March on Washington for jobs and then freedom later on, right, have been reinvented, right, as consistent. Well, I mean, they've been reduced to the dramaturgy, right? My friend Mark Dudzik calls it the pageantry of protest. So people channel like the images, right, of protest. And I remember I got to Seattle for the WTO stuff, and I got up the next morning. My hotel was in the curfew zone, and I had to walk through downtown to get to a meeting. And there'd been one skirmish already, right, in that morning, one or maybe two. And as I walked past some of the kids, it's almost like I could see the video of Grant Park outside the Democratic Convention in 1968 playing in their eyes, right? So you want to relive, I think, about the opening paragraphs in Marx's 18th Brumaire about that you want to relive the great moments of the past, right? But what you do is you append them to presentist concerns. So, like, I'm in New Orleans. I was here 3 years ago during the monument fight. Like, my mother had just died here, so I was here for all of it. And I was struck then that the people who were leading the fight to take down the monuments then, and I hated those monuments. I hated them all my life. I had fantasies of dynamiting them when I was a kid. So I was happy to see them gone. But the people who were leading that fight were also neck deep in the charter school industry. Mm. And part of the outcome, right, was that the current biracial, multiracial, interracial governing class is able to represent having gotten rid of an obsolete symbology of oppression as a backhanded way to legitimize the current dynamic forms of oppression, right, exploitation. So anyway, again, I feel like you asked me what time it is and I told you how to make a watch.
No, that's great. I mean, that comes back actually to a question that popped up in my mind as you were talking before about how quickly the protests went from defund the police to yanking Lincoln down and all that. But right. I mean, I was really struck by the speed with which, suddenly it was the entire range of American iconography. And it felt like the same kind of corporate thought leaders and pundits that seemed like I remember 6 months ago were denouncing Bernie Sanders as on patriotic grounds because he was a Russian agent or whatever it was. Suddenly had this total absence of a patriotic reaction to this. And I was very confused by that, but is that the kind of the same thing? Are we looking at like gesture politics as a replacement for something else or as a stand-in?
I think so.
There?
I mean, well, I tell you, like this time around, I mean, like I've been part of a group that's worked in South Carolina off and on for more 20 decades and spent a lot of time in Charleston. And the one that caught me the most this time, that spoke the loudest to me, was when the Charleston County Council voted without any substantive debate, from what I can see, to take down the big fucking John Calhoun statue in the heart of downtown. I thought, okay, then ruling class is behind this one, right? But yeah, I think ultimately, I mean, and a good friend of mine and I go back and forth about this, and he's right too, right? I mean, like, it's right to take them down, right? It's right that they're gone. It makes everyday life better, right? I mean, it's like trying to imagine, I don't know, a statue to Franco, you know what I mean? Or one to Batista in Cuba, right? I mean, yeah. Or as I mentioned, like in a piece that I wrote about the fight here, having a statue in Berlin to Goering because of his exploits as a World War I aviator, right? I mean, nobody gave a shit about what he did in World War I. It's what he did afterward, right? Yeah. But I mean, that said, like, I think we need to have perspective on this stuff, right? I mean, it's, and I don't know if this is like a function of the extent to which American political culture is like wrapped up with the advertising industry and its logic, but there's a tendency to proclaim the historic significance of stuff in advance almost, you know what I mean? And what that does is it like removes a necessary critical distance between what we're seeing happen before us and trying to make sense of it. right? Like, it's not like another one. I don't like this, is the historic election of Barack Obama. Well, yeah, I mean, it's worthy of note that he was the first publicly acknowledged Black person to be elected president. I'm still holding out for Warren Harding, but he could only have gotten elected because the changes had happened already, right? Because the secular changes had occurred within American politics and within the electorate, right? So in that sense, his election ratified, right, more than augured, mm-hmm. right? You know what I mean? And it's the same kind of thing with this other stuff. I mean, also that there's just so much of a children of the corn, you know, aspect to this kind of politics too, right? I mean, Grant, right? I mean,
right.
Lincoln.
Cervantes was my favorite, but go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's right. They got him too, didn't they?
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
And what did he do exactly?
I don't know. He invented funny stories, I guess. I don't know.
Right, right. Yeah, but I don't think he had a presence in the New World. Did he? Here, did he?
No, he was a slave himself, if I remember correctly. But
oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe that's what it was.
It's just such an interesting moment, and it's so interesting to watch the reaction of kind of sort of national pundit class to all this, because you know, in a different context, the reaction would be completely different. And I just find it very puzzling. So,
yeah, no, me too. I mean, to be honest, I mean, I've been kind of surprised by it. I've been surprised at how many, well, I mean, seeing Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer kneeling like it's the beginning of an HBCU.
I know. Yeah.
Rat step show. Yeah. Right. I kind of wanted to see him. But I'm gonna jump up and make the moves, right? But,
yeah.
but yeah, I mean, the same people who were not 6 months ago, right? I mean, the South Carolina primary was February 29th, were denouncing Sanders, right, for standing for anything, right? And Amy Klobuchar, Buttigieg, whose sole raison d'etre as candidates was to say no, right? You can't have any aspirations, right?
Mm-hmm.
We have to win this election. You can't aspire to anything. And then all of a sudden, like, they're all, you know, made a 180-degree turn, and mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa, and oh, I'm so racist, and take down the police and whatever. Yeah, I don't know what to make of it either.
I also want to give you, I just want to make sure listeners know, speaking of, and viewers know, speaking of, like, you know, the ability to look at history and you said in 1996, I believe, about Obama, you described him in the Village Voice.
Right.
You said, in Chicago, for instance, we've gotten a foretaste of the new breed of foundation-hatched Black communitarian voices, one of them a smooth Harvard lawyer with impeccable do-good credentials and vacuous to repressive neoliberal politics, has won a state Senate seat on a base mainly in the liberal foundation and developmental worlds. His fundamentally bootstrap line was softened by a patina of the rhetoric of authentic community, talking about meetings in kitchens, small-scale solutions to social problems, and the predictable elevation of process over program, the point where identity politics converges with old-fashioned middle-class reform in favoring form over substance. I suspect that his ilk is the wave of the future in U.S. Black politics, as in Haiti and wherever else the IMF has sway. So far, the Black activist response hasn't been up to the challenge. We have to do better.
Well,
that is impressive.
Yeah,
that's a
right?
that's a call and a half right there.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, I mean, the pat on the back is it came out in January, so I wrote it in December, but 1995. But
1995. Okay, sorry. Yeah. It was published
right.
In 96, written in 95.
Yeah. But the real point though is that it underscores something else I say all the time, that it's better often, if not most of the time, to be in the right place at the right time and pay attention than to be smart, right? Because I lived in that district. I worked closely with his predecessor in the seat, and I was involved in the negotiations where she had made a foolish promise to step aside for him, and the debates within the Hyde Park left and foundation left liberal world. So I watched it all. So, I mean, I wasn't pressing. I was just in the birthing room at the outset of this clown's career, right? So, but yeah, I mean, I think that anybody, there's a group of us, right? About a half a dozen of us who were involved in it. And I think anybody who was in that group would have written the same same couple paragraphs, because he was that transparent, right?
Right.
But yeah, I mean, that's him. But I'll take it, right? Yeah. especially because, you know, like I always say too, that the political scientists don't work well at predicting stuff that's going to happen. We do better at predicting what's already
happened. Already happened, right. Yeah. The last question for me is just about this coming election season and what's at stake there. I mean, the extreme irony for me in all this is that for the last 4 years, you know, what you've been talking about, the kind of neoliberal politics, has been sort of universally panned. It's gotten it's single-handedly birthed movements on both the left and the right, and it's had this extraordinary sort of negative power to inspire people in all these different directions. And yet, it looks like it's a pretty good chance that it's going to end up being back in the White House. Right. I just wonder what your feeling is about how this is going to work going forward. And I mean, we don't have to predict who's going to win the election, but is there an irony in all that?
Yeah, I think there is. I mean, less than a month ago, a couple weeks ago, in fact, I would have said, I'm not even sure there's going to be an election, right? I think Trump, this may be wishful thinking, but I think Trump has worked so hard over time at discrediting himself that he wouldn't be able to stop an election. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure that he could win it. And he's starting to look more and more like Andy Griffith in the last scenes of A Face in the Crowd. that may be wishful thinking. But that's the thing. And see, I mean, like in 08, right? Like I said, you know, once Obama got the nomination, I said, look, if it's almost certainly the case that in the short term, we'd be better off. And by we, I mean, progressives or leftists, right, would be better off with Obama in the White House than with McCain in the White House. But you think that we have an obligation to think for both the long term and the short term, not to say that that would alter your behavior, right, in the short term. I mean, not to say that it's a matter of trying to determine whether it's worth it to vote for Biden or to keep Trump in the White House, you know, to sharpen the contradictions like that wing at SDS did. But I think it's worth, if we're going to have anything that's like a left that's trying to build the capacity to fight for a better world, right? To fight for a society that's qualitatively better than the one that we're living in now, we need to start thinking and talking more strategically among ourselves about stuff like this, and not being tied to the election cycle, whatever. I mean, I think we're kind of screwed either way, frankly, right? If Trump wins or stays in office, he might come and kill us. I'm just hoping that those kids who post all their wild stuff on Instagram or tweet it all the time, we'll go in the first wave so that some of the rest of us will have time to grab a toothbrush and head to Canada, right? But if Biden wins, you know, I don't think we're going to get anything from him. I mean, I know people think that well, you know, we can push him maybe closer to Medicare for all. I mean, you know, where I vote in Pennsylvania, right, we have three Congress people in the Philadelphia area that we were trying partly through the Labor for Bernie committee to try to move closer to the Jayapal bill. Once they all endorsed Biden, then from my perspective, I mean, that's over, right? Mm-hmm. Because Biden ran on opposing Medicare for all. And while it's true, I've been joking for the last few weeks, trying to remember when was the last time I heard Joe saying that Americans love their employer provided health insurance so much. But I don't see how we can back up on that. And I mean, Democrats with any political aspirations, right, aren't going to bolt from the ticket, right? So I don't know. I do think it's going to make a difference in the short term. Like, I'm not totally joking when I say that I think Trump will kill us, right? I mean, he would like to. And from that perspective, I think the most we can hope for from a Democratic administration is some time, right? Right, I mean, buying some time. A Supreme Court appointment or two that's not terrible. some better appointments on the National Labor Relations Board, right? Some teeth in OSHA, something like that, right? But the problem is, you know, we didn't elect our way into this situation, and we're not going to elect our way out of it. And we have to finally act like a left that understands organizing as being something different from event planning, right? Like, the big lesson from the primaries is that we don't have the popular constituency out there that we need for our politics. And that means that the number one task has to be trying to go out and create that constituency. And that's going to be the job no matter who's sitting in the White House.
On that note, I have two related questions. One is, what do you see your role as in organizing? Like, what is your role in organizing? And also in terms of organizing, I mean, referring back to the discourse of disparity and disproportionality, I guess, it's interesting because I realized that I often use the disproportionate argument as like a gateway drug for people who don't already get those connections. Because I do think that, like you guys were saying, I'm not going to fight for a more diverse exploited class. Like, that's not the goal. But I do think that probably from an organizing perspective, like, we do, just like we have to explain the class stuff to the white working class, right? Mm-hmm. Like, there are people, I assume, for whom, unless those connections are made or unless they're not dismissed, there won't be kind of like an audience for that or receptiveness to it.
Right.
So how do we do both of those things? And like, what is your role versus the role of, I don't know, a labor organizer or a community organizer?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, two really easy questions to wrap up with.
the honest abstruse, as you might think. I mean, one is my main role as I see it. And like, this is stuff that I've been doing more of because we're on lockdown and I can't get around. My main role is like working on the ground in South Carolina with our Medicare for All, I mean, South Carolina campaign. Because we've got an organizing model that we came together around when we did the Labor Party back in the 90s and won a ballot line for South Carolina party, in fact, in the early 2000s. And we've been organizing around that. And between the beginning of December and the primary at the end of February, you know, we actually got signatures on pledge cards from more than 18,000 South Carolinians, mainly Black, saying that they would prefer not to vote for any candidates who didn't support new Medicare for All. Now, obviously, that's not the way the primary played out, but that just speaks to more to a problem with 50 years or more of electoral politics, and just further, you know, underscored that the work for us is to dig deeper to build a base. The president of the South Carolina State Fed, who comes out of the Longshoremen, is a good friend. I'm his political advisor, and you know, we're trying to take the campaign, you know, through the trade union movement. I take the point about the gateway drug, but I tell you, it's not as necessary as one might think. I mean, every now and then, in talking to rank and file trade union members, but you know, to ordinary working people, I mean, they don't look for the Black issues or for the issues that have been sacralized as the Black issues, right? You talk to people about the stuff that they're concerned about, and we also found, by the way, that you know, part of the organizing 101 manual from the Alinsky-influenced world is that you need to have people give testimony and to tell their stories. No, nobody gave a shit about that. And it's partly because when you're talking to people who are living with the problem, they don't need the horror story from somebody else, right? Right? I mean, they've lived the testimony in their own lives. And so the takeaway for me about that is that those are the people that we want to talk to, and those are the people that we need to talk to. And every now and then, one of them is going to raise a question that suggests the use of the gateway drug. And there's a white gateway drug, too. It's called death panels and that kind of stuff. This is like a good illustration. I had I gave a talk at a steelworkers local in Georgetown, South Carolina. And there are these two white rank and filers. One of them is just a dunderhead, right? He's an old guy who had two ideas that had gotten into his head and the sutures closed around him. One was bring back the manufacturing jobs, and the other was get rid of the immigrants. But the other guy was more complex, and he said to me, you know, like, I like Sanders's economic program, right? And he said, but the thing I don't understand is why the Democrats let themselves get caught up in all the moral issues, like as he referred to them. And I assume he meant stuff like same-sex marriage and feminism and abortion, whatever. So we talked around it, or talked about it, and you know, I didn't know him before, but I'm sure that somebody who had standing with him, because I at least, you know, stopped him for a couple seconds. When I asked him, so which is more, you know, one way to think about this is which is more important to you, that you have, you know, access to healthcare that's guaranteed and of high quality and a good wage, or that no two same-sex people could ever marry, right? And that stopped him for a minute. And I think somebody that he had a real relationship with could work on him. And especially like if you analogize it to the union, I said to him too, look, there's probably somebody in your shift you can't stand his guts. And you can't wait to clock out so you don't have to see him again until the next time you clock in. But I bet you that with that person on union matters, you were able to find a way to work together, right? And so that's the kind of solidarity that we need to try to build with people. And look, some percentage of people who are committed to, you know, the moral issues are going to be committed to it, and we can't do anything about it, and we won't win there. But there are enough people, and we had a pretty significant experience of this kind of thing on our own in the founding of the Labor Party, that some people are going to be willing to swallow their personal preferences, right, for pursuit of a collective goal. And that's the culture that we want to build, and that's the kind of movement that we want to build, and that's the exact opposite of this disposition to treat the movement like it's a frat, right? Like you got to show that you accept all the principles and know all the right words. For me, the gratifying thing is that often enough, it's not a weekly or a monthly occurrence, but like often enough I get an email from some random person at my pen account who will thank me for either having helped them form into coherent ideas, sensations that they had in their head but couldn't put together, or had emboldened them to say out loud things that they had suspected but thought that it wasn't kosher to say. And that's another way you build a network, right? So I try to stay in touch with people like that and put them in touch with one another. And, you know, it's all kind of a part of the organizing project. But the only thing we can do is try to move the ball down the road a bit.
Excellent. Well, Professor, thank you so much.
So, and on a sports reference.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then a sports reference. Yeah. All right. Dr. Reed, thank you so much for coming on. Yeah. Really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks for having me. Yeah, thank you. It was a blast. Take care. All right.
That was great.
Was. I didn't know he was such a sports fan. That's hilarious.
I know, yeah.
I wanted to spend the entire time talking about Duke Carolina games. But by the way, since we have you on camera, we got to ask you, what's your take on the Cam Newton situation?
Cam Newton. Good old Cam Newton. Cam Newton is a very good football player.
Right. And you didn't just find that out.
I've known this in my bones for a while.
Okay.
Cam Newton, I think I did know he was a football player. Cam Newton's a football player. And the big news, of course, is that he just replaced Tom Brady as the...
You're such a cheater. Such a cheater.
You can keep the other stuff in and embarrass me.
Okay, all right.
Matt really wants to humiliate me, as if anyone thinks I'm really good sports... Okay, person. So Cam Newton, of course... Of course, as everyone knows, the great football player has just replaced Tom Brady as the coach of the football team.
The football team.
Known as, give me a hint, refresh my memory.
The Cleveland Unicorns.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
That's funny because Adolph Reed mentioned the Unicorns,
right,
remember?
Yeah.
Wait, there's actually a team called Unicorns?
The Cleveland Unicorns, yeah. In the NFL.
That's really cool. Like, isn't that very, I feel like it's very,
they have great,
like,
helmets.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, I feel like unicorns are very feminized, for better or for worse, and I feel like that's,
it's kind of a, it's a very aggressive uniform, a unicorn in the helmet. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, and so it's more, I see.
Yeah.
It's like a ram, kind of a
kind of, except it's yeah.
I mean, it has one thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. But it kind of runs down the top of the helmet. Yeah. And it's not like a cutesy.
That's what I was thinking. A cutesy rainbowy. I thought it was very like.
No.
You know,
no.
like the.
It's got spikes all over it,
oh,
and everything.
God.
Yeah, it's really
basically
intense.
A monster. It's basically Godzilla. It should be Godzilla.
It's a menacing. Yeah.
The Cleveland Godzilla.
Cleveland unicorns. Yeah. Right. Yes. Exactly.
Cleveland Godzillas. Yeah. I mean, look, Cleveland. The Cleveland unicorns. They're known for being really. They've sharpened over the years. They've sharpened their technique.
Well, they're known for their powerful ground assault.
Yeah. Yeah, as opposed to the aerial bombardments that the New York Giants are known for.
Right. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
No, that makes perfect sense. I think you're going to get high marks for that one. Yeah. So, all right. Well, so Adolph Reed, big Tar Heel fan, big North Carolina fan, but also that was a really cool talk. Touched on a lot of topics that were very apropos to the moment, and I learned a lot, and I hope you did too. And rate and review us. Don't listen to Pod Save America or the X-Files. And keep tuning in, keep listening, and thanks so much. We'll see you again next week.
Yeah, and buy your merch. Get your merch. Get your t-shirts, your mugs. Also, subscribe on YouTube so you get a ding every time you, a ding-dong, whatever, a bell goes off every time we have a new video. You got to subscribe. Just got to do it. If you don't, just, I don't even want to talk to you.
Right. Yes. Katie doesn't even want to talk to you. Yeah. So avoid that. Do the right thing, and we'll see you again next week.
Yeah. We'll be right back.